It is your PrisonPlanet.tv memberships that fund so much of what we do here in this operation. And then we're more than happy for the TV show after it's aired live, then be leaked out onto the web to tens of millions of people. That's our goal. Ladies and gentlemen, the 22nd day of December 2011 on this Thursday edition. I have some of the biggest news I've ever broken on this radio show today. It began to break yesterday when one of our callers, who's called in with a lot of really good tips because her husband works in the Department of Defense. We interviewed him last night. She said, listen, you didn't look at the right area in the documents that I've been sending you. It talks about blue force awareness and how the military mans the FEMA camps and how the rest of the American people are the enemy. And we went and got the documents off the federal government website. And within an hour of it being posted at Infowars.com with links to it, they pulled it. They pulled it. First, they started altering the document in live time. We have the earlier one. And then about by the time I'd talked about it on the radio, but hadn't even done an official piece on it yet yesterday in the afternoon, while we were still on air, by the end of it, they changed dates and removed things. This is in live time on the big federal government, Homeland Security, Department of Defense, contracting website. And then by about an hour and a half after the article had been out at about 6 o'clock Central, 6 p.m. Central. Aaron Dykes and I worked feverishly on top of doing the nightly news to get that out. They removed it completely and put a notice about do not post classified information, if you're a federal employee issuing contracts, implying that it was classified. And I've seen that in contracts before where it's public, then they classify it again. But super creepy. And I did notice, though, I didn't see yesterday, biggest thing ever in all this, the comments. There's like 400 of them there. I've scanned through them. The comments are almost universally saying, whoa, this is big, especially veterans, current military, folks in Afghanistan going, this blue force, red force, all these designations, transponders, this is what we do with the enemy. And I remember being at urban warfare drills in Temple, Texas, in Oakland, California, and other areas. And footage sent to us by listeners all over the nation, the Marines, when they practice taking over a town, the mayor, the police chief, the Boy Scouts in some cases are wearing transponders. They're running around tattling, spying on the militias and gun owners and all these drills. Now it's just admitted that we're the enemy. Real Americans are the enemy. The globalists have a problem, though, because the military's awake and understand what's happening, more and more of them. So it's just off the charts that everybody who doesn't have a transponder badge, terrorist. For the drones, going back even 12 years ago, this is in Police State 2000, but I have then all the raw footage. I've got to, you know what, I've got to dig into that bend before all those VHS tapes go back, because I shot that on VHS before I even got the money to buy a digital camera, a DV cam for like $5,000. I had to save my money and couldn't even buy that then. But I was shooting it on VHS. A used camera I bought for like $100. That's how much money I had even like in 98, 99. And I've got all the raw footage of them giving us a tour, and they've got this Humvee with this big robot 50 cal gun on top of it, maybe been above 50 cal. I've got to pull a video up. And they're talking about, yeah, we can target the insurgents with this, and then it just designates those that don't have a transponder. We hit the button. We can even go get in a dugout or whatever, and the Humvee sits there just killing everybody. And then I'm like, well, what about robots? You've got, and they're like, well, we're not going to get into the swords, which the public was just shown the last 6 years. But we even have even better stuff, but that's classified. And boy, I've talked to the troops. Boy, do they. I mean, they got stuff right out of Terminator. Heck, worse. I mean, we are in so much trouble. And the globalists are getting to the point where they don't even need the troops anymore. It's going to be self-aware robots and drones, and that's in the Washington Post. They're already testing them. There are already drones in the air that make the decision on who to kill. Stay with us. You're going to want to take notes today. I beg you to write down what we're going to cover, the basic points, and then go research it for yourself, because information of this incredible import, of this magnitude, is so important. I have said, Ron Paul has said, other constitutional scholars like Bruce Fine have said, Mr. Turley, constitutional scholar, has said, countless others have looked at this legislation that has passed the House and Senate that Obama says he'll sign but hasn't yet. It's like the calm before the storm. He's hesitating, dropping the sword of Damocles and escalating this into a whole new level. And I think that's because there's a lot of behind-the-scenes jockeying in the power structure. Do they really want to give the president, because that's what this says, absolute power of Kim Jong-il? It says the president can kill any U.S. citizen they want. In fact, I meant to play that Turley clip from C-SPAN last night on the Nightly News. The guys got it ready, but we never played it. You guys go ask Stu to give you the Turley clip to play later in the hour. He'll know the one it is. I mean, this is on record. Kill any U.S. citizen in the U.S. or anywhere else anytime they want. No judge, no jury, no discussion, no need of proof, no one above the president. Absolute dictator. Now, Bush signed executive orders, and Congress went along with it, for PDD 51 and the accompanying other numbers to other federal agencies, because they had executive orders and presidential decision directives. The PDD is 51. There's an executive order that accompanies it, saying that for any crises, including economic or unnamed crises, the president can suspend Congress and run the entire U.S. government. So the presidency, though the presidency is a puppet position by the special interests, the big mega banks, Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, a handful of others, the system is hesitating on this, because I think even the global controllers are saying, should we actually give a president this much power? We already control them. The Congress already does whatever we say and are a bunch of tyrants. We've got dirt on all these people. Do we want to? Because, see, they've actually worked to weaken the office of the presidency in the public mind while strengthening the power that the unelected bureaucracy has under the executive. That's what Nixon was all about. Certainly not a good guy, but he was not a total globalist. And he was not going along with a lot of their operations, and it's come out. We've interviewed people that have gotten the documents. It's even in a lot of mainstream reports that they decided to go ahead and leak stuff on him from the plumbers and the break-in at the Watergate to bring him down. And that's why you saw that happen, because the power structure wanted to bring down Richard Nixon and weaken the presidency. Bill Clinton was put in there to drag the presidency through the mud. So they want the power of a dictatorship, but they want it through the oligarchy, the plutocratic councils and combines, to give the president this power. And this is not rhetoric. It is supreme dictator status. Even kings of old, who said that they had their power as the divine right of blood, and the whole French Norman line believed they were descended of Christ from Mary Magdalene. That's the whole Merovingian line. The Queen of England was sworn in, christened, coronated on the stone of Abraham, and believes that she is of the blood of Christ and all this stuff. These people think they're God. Even they had to issue some kangaroo reasons for why they were going to execute you or put you in the tower and sign an order. This says the president need not even tell anyone and can do whatever they want and not even have proof of anything. It is absolute dictatorship. It's Kim Jong-il level. And so Obama said he was going to sign it last Thursday and then last Friday, and then suddenly there were news articles Obama set to sign NDAA today, and then it was tomorrow, and then now people are saying, well, what's your statement? Are you going to sign it? Because Obama had said he wasn't going to sign it, but then his lawyers are like, because we don't need to have this signed. He already has this power. We'll kill U.S. citizens whatever we want. You saw those announcements. We'll arrest whoever we want. We'll spy on whoever we want. We'll do whatever we want. So we saw all of that unfolding. And then we learned, oh, Obama demanded the provision to arrest, kill, do whatever he wants, torture U.S. citizens. And so now something's going on here. And we'll continue to watch it very, very closely. Now, separately, integrating in with all of this, you've got Newsweek with the headline, governments, local governments armed by Homeland Security to wage war. Remember that headline yesterday? Preparing for war. I've got three other articles today where local governments with tanks, wheeled vehicles, machine guns, combat robots, training for war. And by the way, we've gotten the manuals. Al-Qaeda isn't in the manual. Okay, it's John Deere, cap-wearing, overall-wearing rednecks. Good old boys. People that can skin a buck, run a trot line. You see the drones already targeting, you know, people that, quote, are living on 3,000-acre farm compounds with their families and who, quote, want to be left alone and, quote, aren't paying their property tax. See, nobody's going to be able to pay their property tax except the 0.1% when they're done with this global depression. They're going to come take everything. And a lot of people are going to say, I'm going to sit here on my farm. It's paid off. The property tax is unconstitutional. Hadn't been around but the last 60 years. I'm not going to pay it. And they're going to send military in to kill you. I've been to the urban drills. I've shot video. They practice killing farmers. That's who they practice to have war with under the new rural council. Go look it up on the whitehouse.gov. Who is at the head of the rural council? The Department of Defense and Homeland Security. And you talk about creepy. I mean, deploying plainclothes military as liaisons creeping around your small town. Now, there's a good side effect to this. The military is completely freaking out right now and saying, Alex Jones is 100% right. We apologize. You were always right. They're apologizing to all the other members that told them this years ago. They are all getting right behind Ron Paul. They're all getting chills right now. I mean, this is treason. This is foreign banks that have taken over Europe and the U.S. In Europe, they're saying we're going to send in paramilitary tax collectors in Portugal, in Spain, in Ireland, in Greece. And they're saying, on top of all your other taxes, over 70% on average in Greece in taxes, we're now putting a new 20% VAT on all your restaurants and other tourism spots. And Europeans aren't even, I've got articles today, aren't even buying new electronics. They're going into a depression. The tourism's dying. And the Greeks and others are saying, we're not going to pay it. And so the EU says, then we're going to come and arrest you. They're like, we can't pay. And they're like, that's the plan, Jack. You think when California passed this year a 20%+ carbon tax on all their major industries, that they didn't know that would send California into cardiac arrest? This is by design. You think when King John and Robin Hood's time, that's a true story. Did you know that when he was bankrupting everybody and driving the villagers into the woods, starving to death, that he was an idiot? No, he wasn't an idiot. He was going into Saxon areas that he'd never totally broken and trying to completely drive them into revolt, so he had a reason to kill them and remove the Saxon lords that he thought weren't completely loyal to him. It's called a scorched earth policy, and I'm not going to sit here and get off into an entire story here, but they were Norman who'd come into the South, and they were still engaged in a Cold War against Saxon, who they hadn't completely routed out of the entire imperium or kingdom. But again, I digress. Now, here's the big news that ties into all of this. While the military and the police, and sadly, the police, they can find the types in many cases that get off on this and buy into the propaganda. That's it. The police are who you got to worry about. And a lot of them are waking up too, but not like the military. They've been taught a disdain for the public and the rest of it, many of them. are training for all-out war against the population, and that's now all over mainstream news, because they've got to get ready to let you know. They're not going to hide this anymore. They're not going to hide the world government. They're going to sell it, though, a private banking world government, as what's going to get food back on your table. Of course, it'll just make things worse. It's designed to. It's a post-industrial model. The deeper you get your arm into this thing, and they tell you, well, just stick your arm in a little bit deeper, that'll fix it, the more you can't get out of it. You understand that? It's called a trap. The globalists are in control because they don't want to make things nice, because they don't play by rules, because they want to wreck everything. So they're on top of it. What do big major corporate raiders do? You know, in movies, they're based on a composite of true stories, like Wall Street with Charlie Sheen and Michael Douglas. You know, great movie. It's based on composites of real people. And in that, they go into like a $5 billion company, and they wreck it and implode it just so they can sell off everything and get the pension funds and make a big profit right then, instead of having something that lasted 20 more years and gave thousands of people jobs, because the CEO wants that quick profit right then off of wrecking it and moves on to the next thing. They're not trying to have a healthy tree. They want to chop it down and use it for firewood. They don't want the tree to be there for shade, for animals and things that live in the forest. They want to cut it down to throw in their siege engine, to roll it down the road towards the next town they're going to burn. That's the model. Now, when I come back, probably one of the biggest things we've ever reported, because this confirms the military's going to man the camps and that they're preparing for war. The general public is designated as red, government, what federal family, as Janet Reno Napolitano calls it, is blue. Just like in Afghanistan, our troops are blue, Al-Qaeda is red. You've got a decision to make, and quite frankly, the tyranny we face is disgusting and horrible, but this is what life's all about. You should, quite frankly, thank your lucky stars that you're alive today. I know I do. Because these great challenges are what make us or break us in this life that is a test. And we are facing even greater evil than our forebears did. And we have been hit with every psychotronic, brainwashing, chemical system you can imagine. And so I want to apologize here on air that I've called people that are dumbed down and that laugh at us idiots and zombies. They are brainwashed victims, and some of them are irreparably damaged to a point of no return, and we should say a prayer for them, and I mean that. We should say a prayer for people that have been overrun by this system that the psychological warfare chiefs, the scientific dictators, have established. And it's up to us that have persevered through this and have been somewhat immune or more resistant. It is up to us, the strong, to protect the weak from these bullies that have a global scorched earth eugenics policy facing our society. Now, coming up in the next segment, I'm going to get to this article from C-SPAN. The second most cited law professor in the country, Jonathan Turley, talks about the fact that this does allow the killing of U.S. citizens, secret torture and arrest. That's actually what's in the bill. You can go read it yourself. But the point is, Ron Paul's telling you this. I'm telling you this. Other scholars are telling you this. Go read the bill. Ron Paul, I saw a clip up at Infowars.com last night. It was at a town hall in Iowa. And he said, I'm tired of Congress lying to the American people and the media and telling you the NDAA doesn't affect you. It does. Here's the subsection. But then when they're late night debating it, the authors of the bill get up and say, yeah, it affects citizens. President can kill anybody he wants. We want you to be scared of that and scared of torture. I played the clips on the nightly news. I posted them. I mean, it's so creepy to watch these weird, evil old men. You know, a friendly old man like a Hoppy Heidelberg, it's so nice and good. And they put off an aura of wisdom and friendliness and goodness, but an evil old man. There's nothing nastier than a wicked, demonic old man where the evil just piles up on him. Like in A Christmas Carol, where the chains of greed are just wrapped so tightly, around Scrooge's old partner when he sees his ghost. He says, Scrooge, beware. Your chains are twice this length and weight. You think greed and having, you know, some of the starving kids of your employees dying put spiritual chains on you? How about consciously putting sodium fluoride and radioactive isotopes in 72% of U.S. water supplies? On record, you're a new listener and you're like, what? Just type in, Governor Perry covered up radioactive isotopes in Texas water. You know why that cover-up happened? Because I talked about it in the last few years. State employees finally heard the show, leaked it, and said, yeah, we're told to cover up the test. It's in the fluoride. And then the media spun it. We don't know why it's in the water, but the state did cover it up because the feds told them to move along. I'm going to say it again to cops listening and military. The criminal eugenicist crazy scientist who think we're a cancer and want to get rid of us and who get off on playing with us like lab rats. My dad said in high school when he two summers worked at MD Anderson, most of the research scientists were really nice, really good people. But he said sometimes when they were doing experiments on people that had signed over because they were dying of cancer and missing their lower mandibles and just horror, my dad said you couldn't believe. And he worked there also in college. Under, I forget the guy's name, some top Chinese cancer scientist. And he said, you know, just whole wards of people at MD Anderson, top cancer research facility, missing their lower mandibles, missing part of their head, you know, kids in there, animals. But he said some of those scientists got off on the pain. And they'd be injecting somebody with something that was really painful. And they'd be going, just getting off on it. Or people be injecting lab rats and getting off on them dying. And my dad was like, ugh, what is this in research science? I'll interview my dad sometime. Well, it'd be an interesting interview. But he's too self-deprecating to get on air. The point is, that's what we're facing. That's what we're dealing with, is people who just... It's like when Eric Pianka's graduates, some of them that are medical doctors, sent me threatening emails when I exposed the UT guy calling for mass death of 90% and made national news. You know, his graduate sent me stuff and said, you know, we're going to kill everybody. And then I went and looked them up, and there they were in white lab coats at bioweapon facilities. By the way, we're going to be here this Christmas on the air with a premier special Christmas transmission. And I need to get a little bit into the war on Christmas. I don't talk enough about that, but it's all about the globalist dictating how we talk, what we do, what we celebrate, and using American and Western hospitality to train us to just totally give up any culture we had and accept the plastic Madison Avenue garbage, the Justin Bieber type New World Order stuff where Britney Spears says, I think we ought to just do whatever our president says and that's the end of it. Well, it doesn't matter if you don't do whatever your president says. Under this NDAA, it makes him supreme dictator and establishes martial law. In fact, let's go ahead and go to the C-SPAN clip. Even though this is one of the most important things we were going to cover last night on the nightly news, I got so overwhelmed with our big top story I'm getting to in a moment that I didn't even play this. So here it is. Government says it can assassinate or indefinitely detain Americans on American soil without any due process. Okay? Face it. You're like, well, they're the good guys. Really, 9% of the public likes Congress. Do you really think they're the good guys? No, you know they're not. And so instead of being scared and going, well, I'll just stay out of this, or, oh, it's not that bad, don't be a coward. And I know our longtime listeners aren't, but we're on a lot of AM and FM stations, upwards of 100 now. We're on XM. We're on Global Shortwave. We're number one audio streams on the internet for talk radio, many times above music on Shoutcast. Number one routinely, period. We got a lot of new listeners. And if you just tuned in, listen, this stuff's real. History's real. And you ignore this at your peril and all of our peril. We need you to make a decision, to get informed, to look at the facts, and to decide what side you're on. And to saddle up in the 21st century as the Paul Revere's you are. Whether you're black, Hispanic, white, Asian, Catholic, Christian, Jewish, Hindu, atheist, whatever. We know what tyranny looks like. Everybody knows in every science fiction movie set in a dystopic future, black uniform, ski mask, face scanning cameras, checkpoints. Of course, they don't grab children's genitals in those. We're worse than that, you know, with the TSA. And in those, you know, they have to cook something up to secretly arrest you and detain you. You know, October is bonus recruitment month. Remember, cadre kids, report a family member and receive a double credit. Brought to you by Cadre Cola. I mean, that's from the mid-1980s Running Man, written by Stephen King, where anyone caught outside of their zone after dark will be permanently detained. You're like, oh, imagine a world run by mega corporations with Running Man shows, you know, hunting people, and if you get caught outside after dark, you're permanently detained. They're talking about permanently detaining any... Did you know the government of the United States for decades tortures people? They torture political dissidents. They torture peaceful people. They torture doctors that refuse to be part of Medicaid or Medicare. Like what Dr. Sell, last time I checked, spent 10 years in solitary confinement being forced drug because he sued him back. Congressman Hansen, they drove him around for months, only letting him off maybe 20 minutes a day off the bus till his feet burst. Okay, this is what they do. We were talking to a prominent nutrition company the other day, and the guy, for just promoting whey powder and stuff, that's milk protein, was dieseled, I think he said, for 7 months, living on government transports as a form of torture. And they get off on it. The dungeon keepers, psychically, spiritually, for whatever reason, for the same reason psychos like to grab little kids and torture them, they feed off the aura of chained humans in pain. You know, look at Abu Ghraib. They knew it was coming out, so the media ran with people tied up with dog chains and dead bodies and stuff like that. The Army's own report, Army report on Abu Ghraib, General Tagumbu, U.S. Filipino background general, General Tagumbu. They admitted at camps all over Iraq they rape children as young as 4 in front of their parents and put acid into their rectums. Go read it. Oh, we're the good guys. Jack Bauer does that. That's how you fight Al-Qaeda. Raping 5-year-old children. I mean, I hate to talk about this on air. This is the pit demons that run our government. The absolute total demons of hell. And they want to drop the hammer first before they start arresting people and doing it to us. And I got news for the system. You're getting rid of the rule of law and everything else. I don't. It's just all a complete fraud. The whole thing's illegitimate. And I know the average cop's a good guy, the average military. Doesn't matter. I'm sure there were nice cops in Nazi Germany and nice military. You work for a hijacked government. I've explained this before. If you were got on a city bus and a guy ran into the bus with a machine gun and dynamite around their chest and said, I'm taking over, and he pistol whipped the driver and put on the driver's uniform, would you just immediately do whatever he said? Studies show, you can pull this up with Stockholm Syndrome, been around forever, but they just named it, that about, 45% will totally submit and love the guy with the dynamite tied to him. See, I'm the bad man. I don't like the guy because he's wearing the bus driver cap with the dynamite strapped to him. I'm like, hey, you're not the bus driver, pal. You're a treasonous usurper. And they're like, I'll light the dynamite. And at a certain point, you've got to just deal with it. You can't just keep giving in to these terrorists who terrorize us with the terrorism. I mean, let's say you believe the terrorism's all real, and you ignore the fact that Al-Qaeda was created by the criminals that run our government and is being given control of all these countries right now and all the rest of this. Let's just say, okay, it's all real. Okay, we're going to do a piece actually tonight where you've got a better chance. We've got the statistics from the Justice Department, from World Almanac and others. You got a better chance of a vending machine falling over on you than being killed by terrorists. You've got a better chance of being struck by lightning. I mean, you know the statistics. We're going to show a whole bunch of them tonight. You got a better chance of being eaten by an American alligator, which is very rare. So, but it's not rare to be killed by an elephant or a hippopotamus if you live in Africa. We're going to get into those numbers. Much better chance of dying from a rattlesnake bite here in the U.S. than being killed by terrorists. So there's the whole hoax of our whole society changes, and the police are dressed in black uniforms, and there's checkpoints being set up, and they're groping our wives and daughters and children because of terrorism. And then in every case, you find out the government opens the door for the patsy lunatics that they use to attack us. And it's back in the news today where the criminals that run our government are funding terrorists. So at a primitive level, people look different than us, different culture, and there's all these shows and South Park and Team America, and it's fun to get into fear of the Muslims. And okay, well, then why is the government bringing them in record numbers? I mean, they're just all absolute devils who want to slit our throats. Okay, let's expand on that. If that's the case, then I mean, how do you square up Amiral Awlaki, number three in Al-Qaeda, meeting secretly at the Pentagon? How do you square up the head of the 7-7 bombers, on record being MI6, Fox News, London Telegraph? Former FBI top chief, Loftus, exposing that. They're not all terrorists at the FBI. Got Mr. German from the FBI going public years ago saying they're getting ready for martial law. In Ventura's martial law piece, that's why the show was banned, because the show was 99% on target. It was bullseye, baby. You got the bullseye right in the middle of the dartboard? It was 90% into the red, barely touching the next ring. That show was so on target. And they're like, that's not airing again. This is a complete blueprint for what we're doing. I mean, it's not like we don't know the FEMA camp plan. We have the congressional hearings. We have the Wall Street Journal. We have the purchase orders. We have all this. But you notice when they put out bids for FEMA camps in 2006 for civil emergency and catastrophic attacks and civil disorder, that at least the Wall Street Journal said, oh, look, here's giant bids to build FEMA camps. Now that they got Department of Defense under rural affairs running it, designating government employees as blue, U.S. citizens as red, in the same designation as Iraq and Afghanistan, where they're wearing transponders, and they talk about, you know, deploying forces, barricades, you know, delivering, I mean, it's all for the drones. GPS in your front door. Even I can't believe this, to actually see it happening and to see them now flipping the power switches on. It's one thing to have a gun in the gun case. But now they've gone to the combination, they've opened it, they've gotten the M14 out, they've taken a loaded cartridge, and they've jammed it in, and they're now loading around in, chambering around, and now they're pointing it at us. And the documents say they're going to pull the trigger because they've designed the implosion. And in the implosion, the police, the military, everybody who goes along with this, you destroy yourself as well. It's not like you're having martial law because a nuke went off from real terrorists, or a meteor hit us, or those giant, you know, 10.5 earthquakes all over the U.S. or something. And then there's looting and whatever, and the troops have got to be called out. This isn't some legitimate contingency plan. This is a controlled demolition on record for a post-industrial America by criminal terrorist banking oligarchs who publicly created the 1.5 quadrillion that had our treasonous government sign on to it. This is bondage. This is economic conquest with a paramilitary backup behind it. Now, we're 44 minutes into this transmission, and I'm going to open the phones up for the entire second hour ahead of Don Browning, one of the cops they haven't killed yet, who has the courage to come on. He's a retired Oklahoma City police officer, U.S. Marine and Vietnam veteran. Don worked with a canine unit, was part of the search and rescue team at the Murrah building after the bombing. And they've talked to a bunch of cops off record and Department of Defense bomb disposal people. But a lot of them are on record in this film, including the inventor of the neutron bomb, the former head of Air Force Weapons Development, and others saying there were bombs in the building. We have newscasts where they're removing them before they got their talking points straight. And they went to these cops and others and they said, we know where your daughter goes to school. We know where your son goes. We're going to kill him. Can you imagine being a cop or a Department of Defense bomb disposal, and you're like, these are bombs in here? And they're like, your daughter, Jenny, who goes to school here, you want us to kill her? We got a file on you. I mean, I don't know what, I mean, somebody threatened to kill my kids right there. I mean, I'm not Mr. Tough Guy, folks, but let me tell you something. Woo. I mean, you just, this is what, I mean, imagine being a cop, and the guy is threatening you or threatening your family. This is who runs America. And there's not that many of them. The criminals at the top always give us a ledger, a story, a fable to follow what they're saying and doing. But if you ever look at it from just another angle, you find out, oh, I'm not doing this because of the reason they say. I'm compartmentalized. I'm doing it because these are a bunch of knuckle-dragging crooks. I talked to some top financial experts off the record yesterday. I may be able to get the guy on this Sunday. I'm going to be on Christmas. New show, Christmas premiere. And because these are times we got to get the information out. And the word is in D.C. and New York, Corzine is going to be allowed to keep the money. In London bank accounts, he's put it in. And this is the new precedent where they're just going to take everything publicly and not get in trouble. So our worst fears are being confirmed there. I mean, you want to live in a world like that? Where you got some little dwarf, demonic, pig-faced person, little soft, chicken neck, not living in reality, Kim Jong-il running your life? Because giving in to government, that's what it does. How did the North Koreans set up the greatest police state dehumanization grid in human history? How did the North Koreans do that? They had been, at the end of World War II, already starving. Then the communists, Chinese, and Russians backed them. There was a huge war, which hundreds and hundreds of thousands died on both sides. And things were so destroyed that they were able to set up a total control grid from the very beginning. That's why the globalists want to destroy everything economically here. Because it's about total control. So the only way out, you think it's fun risking my life, and believe me, I am, and I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for your prayers. Do you think it's fun risking my family? No, it's not. But there is no future. There is no future for anybody if we don't beat the scientific dictatorship. They are the worst of the worst. And there's no utopia. A lot of people say, oh, what are you going to do? The world's always been bad. No, it hadn't always been like this. There have been a lot of elites who were in control but actually wanted to build up society and educate people. Those have been called golden ages in different societies. This is people that want a dark age, a technocratic nightmare dark age, where they enjoy all the high-tech systems, and then we, those of us that are allowed to live, live in post-industrial squalor for their power-tripping enjoyment. And I believe in humanity. I believe in life. And so I've got to not even bet myself and my family and my treasure and my sacred honor. It's not my betting. I have to make the decision to be on the side of good for my soul. You can call it your psyche, who you are, what you stand for if you don't believe in spiritual issues. The point is that the decision is the most important thing. It's about what's in here, okay? It's about what's in here. And I have to be an example to others. I have to face the threats and the things that go on and move forward, just like Ron Paul does. Because it is in that service to humanity that we build on society and make things better. There were countless people who we don't even know their names, of every color and creed before us, who gave everything they had for human dignity. And we are the brothers and sisters of those people in eternity. The value of that to my soul is the greatest gift and the ultimate treasure. To be with the good, to stand with the light, to stand in goodness in a wicked world where they tell you there is no good or evil. That is the greatest lie, to say there isn't good and evil, to say there isn't that choice and free will. All right, I've talked for 50 minutes. I want to give the number out, and I want to get to our top story. I've mentioned it some, and I'd hope it's not pearls before swine, because this is so big. Go to Infowars.com, exclusive military to designate U.S. citizens as enemies during collapse, period. The entire population is the enemy. And even mainstream news is writing separately how they're preparing for war against the general public. So the government's help with foreign banks destroy the country. Now they're going to pose as the saviors as everything melts down. FEMA continuity of government plans prep total takeover of society, dispatching military domestically under economic collapse emergency. And it's set up on the blue/red contingency operation of the Pentagon, where the United States under NORTHCOM has declared a war zone, as they've already told you, but that all U.S. citizens are enemies unless carrying blue team transponders. So, okay, here's the toll-free number to join us in the next hour. I want to hear from you. In fact, I want to do this again, but I promise I'm going to get to you quick so you're not going to be on hold. Police and military in the first 10 calls or so, the first few rounds, then everybody. I want to hear now that you see all this happening and these open announcements that the government will kill citizens, arrest. Now this secret document, they're now saying it's secret. It was on the Department of Defense website with a link to it. And then they pulled it and put a notice saying that it was classified last night. And we have screenshots of all of this, and we saved the document. It's up at Infowars.com. Now, Joe Joseph, and I'm getting him on tomorrow because that's the day he can take off early, works in highly classified areas. He's a former naval veteran, but he works in stuff connected to Space Command and a bunch of other areas, obviously dealing with satellites. But it was his wife kept calling in and saying, look at this, look at that. And I said, how are you finding this stuff? She said, well, my husband works at the Department of Defense. Well, I had him on last night. His interview, we're going to post it right now. Aaron's in there posting it right now. The video interview from the Nightly News is going up in the area that says exclusive. Military to designate U.S. citizens as enemies during collapse, period. Your wife, your children, all of you. And we already know that, how they treat us. That's what the shoving their hands down our pants is about. It's all about breaking our will. They have body scanners now in Iraq and other areas. In Afghanistan, they face scan you, put you through it, search you. This is total prisoner processing. So I just want to warn everybody about how real this is. I want to hear from police and military. Active duty, current. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. But get this article out to everybody. Go read it. Go read the documents. But what's creepy is within an hour of us talking about it on air, before we even had put an article up, they were changing it and erasing stuff. But we already had it saved, and we have that original one. Then they just totally pulled it and put it up saying, Department of Defense employees should not be posting classified things on here. Implying that that was classified. The point is, folks, this is where they talk about the government wears transponders and is blue. Everybody else is the enemy. The military mans the camps. They're activating them. Right as they announce they want to get rid of posse comitatus and they want troops on the streets. You're seeing it all over the news. Let's go to part of constitutional law scholar and Professor Jonathan Turley on C-SPAN. Here it is.
President Obama just stated that he is going to maintain a policy that he can have any American citizen killed without any charge, without any review except his own. He is, if he's satisfied that you are a terrorist, he says that he can kill you anywhere in the world, including the United States. Two of his aides were just at a panel a couple of weeks ago, and they reaffirmed they believe that American citizens can be killed on the order of the president anywhere, including the United States. That has left civil libertarians, you know, heads exploding. The polls, we've had three polls in the last year, and they all show the same thing. The American people say that they are more afraid of the government than they are outside forces, like terrorists.
Well, that's because the American people, yeah, even the most hardcore liberals are now buying guns in these big studies that he was just mentioning that we posted last week at InfoWars and Prison Planet. Even the liberals are buying guns and now say they're more afraid of big government than big business. Now, you have to understand, big business runs the big government. Okay? The Republican leadership will not tell you that. That's the big, dirty secret. It's mega corporations against the free market, using government power to get the job done. Oldest trick in the book, John D. Rockefeller, Competition's a Sin. All right, we're coming back with your phone calls. They keep getting mad at me because I never plugged this, and it's important to the fight. We are running the 15-day free trial again. It was so popular for the Nightly News at PrisonPlanet.tv. All the films, 9 years up there in April, everything at PrisonPlanet.tv. It's a great way to still give the gift, too. You can go sign up and give it as an e-card to friends and family for this Christmas, the gift of truth at Infowars.com. We're now into hour number two, and I want to open the phones up, as we've been doing once a week or so in the last month, for active duty police, military. But also, if you just retired or you're the wife of a police officer or husband, whatever, I want your view. I'd ask for judges to call in. I know there's a lot of judges even here in town that listen. I've talked to some of them. They're pretty freaked out about all of this. What do you think of the government saying we'll kill citizens, not just secretly arrest you, and the president's a dictator? Doesn't mean he won't leave office. The office has been turned into a dictatorial post of the elite. 1-800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Open phones for police and military right now. And I'll get more into this exclusive military to designate U.S. citizens as enemies during collapse. And it confirms the Pentagon to run the FEMA camps against U.S. citizens, that it's military domestically. Then we've got other crazy articles. Flashpoint Falcons, Britain's talking about a new war again with Argentina and Brazil. IBM predicts mind-reading machines. I've got another report here of a whole bunch of Stinger missiles going to China. Things are crazy. In a ship they caught in Europe, a bunch on Ron Paul, how they're coming after him. I haven't even gotten into that yet. But Ronaldo, who is a current police officer somewhere in New York. Ronaldo, thanks for calling in. What's your view on all this?
Very shocked at what's, well, I'm not shocked at what's going on. I've been listening to you for years, and it's just shocked to see everything taking place as the way you said it. You know, and I remember I seen you years ago when you were in New York, and then I started doing research on you. And I seen everything you said has come to pass now. As they say, the chicken is coming home to roost, and it's like the public is just brain dead. You know, I try to talk to my coworkers, and, you know, some of them listen, and some of them don't, and it's just sad, as you know, the state that we're heading here in this nation.
Well, I tell you, New York City is going to be a scary place to be in a total collapse.
Well, you know what? I'll tell you this, Alex. Some of my coworkers kind of know something is going on, and a lot of them are getting their guns and food, you know, ready for what's going to go on. You know, and I've been doing that already, you know, so I wouldn't be surprised if it looks like New Orleans here.
I hope not. I mean, the colleagues that are waking up, what are they saying?
Oh, well, you know what? They feel that something is not right, you know, as far as, like, the way the economy, just everything is going on, but they just can't, you know, put two and two together that everything is, you know, we're being directed, like you said, into this planned implosion, you know? So they just can't put their head on it as far as, like, what's going on, you know? But like I said, you know, I've tried to put them on to you. I've tried to put them on to alternative media, and some of them are waking up.
Well, God bless them then. That's good, because I would not want the job the police are going to have in this situation. Again, there's a good chance, because we got the jump on the globalist, that a lot of this isn't going to go the way they want. The problem is, it's like a big war machine, a juggernaut, a big engine. They've turned it loose, and I don't think they can even stop it now. So it is going to be a very interesting time to be alive. I got news here where they're saying they're going to hit Iran soon, that Obama's behind it. The Israeli press is saying that. And you know, the globalists aren't just going to try to take over domestically without launching a war, because they know that people at a primitive level tend to rally around the government, even if it's run by criminals. I mean, look what happened in Germany. I mean, Hitler wasn't very popular the last 4 or 5 years, but he had them in a big war. And so 20 million Germans died. I mean, there were only 60-something million. Think of that. Think of what following orders got them into.
Exactly, Alex, and I've been telling telling people in general just about, you know, we need to make sure that this war does not happen, you know, or else it's going to lead to World War III, and that's the last thing we need, and that's why I'm telling everybody to vote for Ron Paul. I've been pushing, you know, out that message.
Well, God bless you, sir. I appreciate you calling. Anything else you wanted to add, Ronaldo?
First of all, one thing about the racist thing around Paul, I remind
you. Stay there. We got to go to break. Stay right there, Ronaldo. We'll be right back to you. We are now into hour number two on this Thursday, 22nd day of December, 2011. Only 8 days or so left. It'll be 2012 time as the globalists openly try to establish world government based on an anti-human eugenics or Nazi type situation. Freeman, Matt, Mike, Perry, and others, you're coming up. A lot of times when I open the phones up for police and military, active duty or currently serving, I say, you know, I want to hear what you think about this legislation to arrest citizens we've covered in the last month and let the military engage in domestic operations and even kill citizens outside of law or charges. And normally the phones load up. We got one police officer from New York City to call in. He was almost in the last segment if you just joined us. And he said some of the other peace officers are waking up. They are know that a big collapse is obviously a serious probability now, from being a possibility to a probability, unfortunately. We're in a depression, undoubtedly. It's just incrementally getting worse. But if you just joined us, we also have been talking about this new document that was pointed out to us on the federal bid website, you know, .gov site, saying, you know, military to run the camps, to take over all of society, to take over local government. Government will wear transponders that they're blue friendlies. Everyone else is an enemy. And I had the Department of Defense whistleblower on who pointed it out to us. Now, an hour after we linked to it, it was pulled. When I mentioned it on air, they started changing it and removing stuff. We'd already saved it. But a lot of the key stuff was still there. Then they just pulled it and said, you know, Department of Defense employees are not supposed to, remember, do not post classified material, implying it was classified. But we have it saved up at Infowars.com. And there's other files of it online as well. And we also got put it up on a Flickr account, images of it. But it's all there. And we've also found some other versions of it people saved, so we're going to link to those. I meant to tell Aaron to do that. But going back, Ronaldo wanted to bring up the Ron Paul thing, and I was going to get to that later. They're bringing up newsletters. This is a controversy since he ran for Congress. He was in one term back in the 80s, lost because he was a Libertarian member. Then he got in as a Republican in, 96. I supported him. I mean, I interviewed him when he was campaigning in 96. And so I've been interviewing Ron Paul for almost 17 years because his district used to come right up into Austin. But I'm going to go to our guest. He wanted to, our guest caller. I wanted to just point this out. I'm not an apologist for anybody. Ron Paul put, back then, newsletters were the hottest thing in the world. They're still hot. But political newsletters were churned out. And at one time, by 92, he had 14 newsletters under his name. And I remember learning later why he fired some people, and no one knew this, and I probably shouldn't talk about it. He ended up firing a whole group of people that worked for him because of it, before it was ever an issue. When he was first in Congress in the 80s, this is on record, you can go look it up, he voted for the Martin Luther King Day, the only time he voted for something that's unconstitutional. He's on record, because he, you know, it is unconstitutional just to have, quote, days for a person. That's not in the Constitution, but he did it. And he said that's the one time, because he admires him for standing up for what he believed in and fighting corruption and you know, the power of liberty. That's what Ron Paul's into. He's always been. You can pull him up on Morton Downey Jr. in the 80s talking about stuff like this and AIDS being manufactured to kill black people. Somebody who wants to be racist towards black people but doesn't want the HIV put in the, you know, in the vaccines to kill them. And so, yeah, there's some stuff like, yeah, the, you know, they'll stop, you know, the black folks in L.A. will stop rioting when the welfare check gets there. Well, I mean, that is what dependency does. And I don't, Ron Paul says he didn't write that particular one because it'd be like JonesReport.com. And I've had a lot of articles written, probably 95% of it I haven't written. I mean, you just pick through it. 14 different newsletters simultaneously being published, and one was a special supplement edition that on record he didn't write. And they go, well, but your name's on it. Yeah, at the top, Ron Paul Report. So that's what goes on. So Ron Paul fired people back whenever he, you know, noticed this. It became an issue in the mid-90s. And it doesn't matter. Ron Paul in speeches and Ron Paul in events and Ron Paul working in inner city hospitals, at charity hospitals, who Ron Paul is has always stood there. And he doesn't want all these wars killing brown people everywhere. So it is this use of race that they always push to divide people. And they brought this up against Rand and said he wasn't a medical doctor, kidnapped women, worshipped aqua Buddhas. All of it was just made up craziness. Had people dress up in hayseed outfits, which is insulting to rural people, whether they be black, white, or whatever. They all pretty much dress the same, folks. I've been out in the country quite a bit, live there. You know, family's got a ranch. I mean, the black folks dress like the white folks, and they're John Deere hats and overalls. Dress up like that and go out with racist signs saying racist things, implying white people who wear overalls are a bunch of racists. They got caught doing that. The Democrats did. So you've got all these dirty tricks going on. You know, Obama unfroze the money for Africa for basically forced abortions, where they tell the women, you want to get a small payment, have an abortion. So see, killing black babies isn't racist. But out of thousands and thousands and thousands, I mean, if you've got newsletters published every week, 14 of them at one time, quite a big franchise. And Ron Paul said, yeah, the company with the 20 or so people was making millions a year, you know, profit or gross, not profit. But yeah, it was, and I apologize. And it was immoral that I didn't have total control over all this as a full-time practicing obstetrician delivering babies. And I let it get out of control, and I apologize. And so they only bring it back because they first told you he couldn't win. Now they say he'll discredit the caucuses. They're going to cheat him on the black box in New Hampshire. Be ready for that. But there's a strategy to beat it. We got a special guest coming up Sunday. We'll be on Christmas with a whole new show. But going to Ronaldo, a police officer in New York, I wanted to preface it because I meant to get to that earlier. Go ahead and make your point, sir.
Well, I wanted to say I was listening to the neocons on radio last week, and it was disgusting at how they were bringing up this point exact about the newsletters. You could see of how all of them had talking points. They were demonizing him. So, you know, at the end of the day, like you said, you know, he didn't have control over the newsletters, and it was.
Yeah, but how come Limbaugh can have a thing called Obama the Magic Negro, clearly racist, and it was okay though? I mean, that was airing 3.5 years ago. You know, not some thing saying, yeah, the blacks when they get their welfare check and it'll stop rioting, and then somebody else wrote it. I mean, what's more, Obama the Magic Negro that the neocons are doing, or what Ron Paul didn't do?
Exactly. You're right about that, Alex. But thank you very much for all the work that you're doing, and I'll try my best to keep spreading the information out there.
Well, let me stop ranting because I cut into what you said because I get so excited. Ronaldo, other points about Ron Paul. You say you're talking to the other police officers. Is any of this demonization of him working? Because polls show he's only going up. And, oh, by the way, I have an article right here. CNN poll, Ron Paul, most popular Republican amongst non-whites. I mean, is it rhetoric people want, or do you want the brown people to stop getting smart bombed by the Predator drones?
Well, you know what? I keep showing people videos of Ron Paul, like information on the internet, and a lot of them are starting to believe in him because they've seen that he's consistent, unlike the other candidates who just straight out lie in your face, like Gingrich, Romney, and Michelle Bachmann, who wants war when she was never even a veteran. But like I said, thank you very much for the hard work, Alex, and I'll continue to spread the information out there.
Ronaldo, let me just ask you one last question. You say you've been awake for a while talking to other police officers. Are they starting to wake up?
Yes, some of them are, but at the end of the day, you can't reach everybody, and I move on and put the information out here and there, Alex.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your call. All right, I'm going to go through some more calls and then get into the other news I haven't covered yet, but I do want to hear from people. I mean, are you concerned that we now confirm the FEMA camps are going to be Pentagon-run and that the American people, period, are designated as an enemy? That's what NORTHCOM did, made this a war zone. They've said the whole America's a battlefield. We'll kill whoever we want. And then you find out it's not even about, quote, Muslim extremists. It's all about good old boys. It's all about self-sufficient people. Freeman in Oklahoma, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hey, Alex, how are you doing?
Pretty good, sir.
Yeah, I'm a former military, retired, well, disabled vet.
What's your view of all this?
Well, I'm not, this NDAA is a bunch of BS, I think. It's ridiculous. I mean, I was in all three components of the Army within the first year, and being in the Guard and the Reserve, we were... I mean, they had us out on the streets doing stuff. And so I was like, okay, this is a little bit strange. And now they're talking about imprisoning citizens and all this. It's ridiculous.
Well, they know they're getting ready to collapse the country. But, yeah, no, all over the country in the last 10 years, high school football games, random highways, the videos come in almost every week of just troops searching cars, regular Army, big Army, National Guard, Marines, Air Force MPs with TSA. And I'm like, hey, this is going on. You should be concerned. They're getting us ready for it. And that's the thing. When they bring the military in, they didn't do it for whatever cover story they've got. They've been getting ready for this for a long time, Freeman, obviously, as you know.
Yeah. I mean, they were out. Well, when I was in, we were training for minor stuff like that, it seemed like. And I was like, why are we doing some of this stuff? This is pointless. And now I'm starting to see it all fit together.
No, they just have you, you're like, why do we go to a baseball game and stand around and search little kids' purses? Because you're training that little kid to be a slave.
Yeah, they had us doing stuff like that, too. And I'm like, no.
No, I know. I've gotten countless State Guards and National Guard videos and photos at high school football games searching little kids. And it's just so little kids get trained, men in green uniforms, search me. Do you want to tell any more of those stories about searching people's bags? Where'd you do that?
Well, we actually did that at a game we went to up here in this town called Chickasha one time.
Stay there. I want to hear about this, and we'll go to Matt, Mike, Perry, and others. Yeah, I've got it in my films like Martial Law, 3-hour documentary, but you can look it up in your town, and you just show up at the basketball game, the football game, or you're driving on the highway, and there's National Guard wanting to search your car or search your kids. And it's 100% acclamation for the local police, everybody. So when they take over America, the troops, the public, everybody just goes, well, that's what they do. Remember 2 years ago, it's in my Police State 4 film, they were setting up 15 different agencies with Homeland Security running it, TSA, Air Force, Army, State Police, DEA, FBI. It was 15 agencies in Tennessee and in four surrounding states were just shutting down highways and searching people. People were freaking out, even in small towns. And the governor said, feds, get out of here. You can't do it. And they literally said, John Warner Defense Authorization Act, shut up. And now Tennessee, you saw it in the news 2 months ago in other states, has TSA checkpoints in it. And man, I saw the video on the news. The families drive up to these checkpoints and they've got the state police with those Marine Corps drill sergeant hats and they got their hands out to their side like they're looking at Al Qaeda and they're just like, oh, oh God, Al Qaeda's everywhere. With the Army and TSA out there. I mean, you're just pulling up into pure treason and they're all jacked up out of their minds like it's all real. Crazy people. And you notice we had one police officer with the courage to call in. I guarantee you they're out there with little Marine Corps hats on listening, going, yeah, they're an enemy, the American people. Okay, whatever. Side with the foreign banks. Go along with it because you're so scared of Al-Qaeda that works for the Pentagon. I mean, it just, you will not wake up, will you? A lot of you are, but I don't know when. I mean, I don't know what it's going to take. It doesn't matter, though. You will be judged for what you're part of, and I'm going to stop ranting. Freeman, real quick, so how long ago, you said you got out of the regular Army and were in the National Guard. How long ago were you going around to, you know, to the football games and things, searching people?
This was back in 2006. And they told us that this was training for, trained to check kids in Iraq. Is what they told us.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And was it a baseball, football, basketball? What was it?
It was a baseball game.
And, I mean, the families just came through and the military searched them?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a total psyop. God bless you. Well, wow. And imagine you're in the National Guard going, this is stupid. I mean, I've got videos and photos of 3-year-old girls in one case, and she's got a little purse. And the military searches it. I'm sorry, I shouldn't laugh. This is so sick. Matt in Ohio. Matt, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hi, Alex. How you doing?
Pretty good, sir.
This is kind of off topic, but I just wanted to bring it up. I didn't know if you heard anything about it. Have you heard about this $1 trillion lawsuit that's supposed to be filed against the United Nations and the Federal Reserve? On behalf of a something called the Dragon Family. I actually checked on pacer.gov, and this actually exists, the lawsuit. It looks like they're trying to sue all these people because of gold that was taken away from them years ago, and the person behind it that's been reporting on it is Benjamin Fulford. I don't know too much about him. I don't know if he's legitimate or not.
I've been hearing a lot about Benjamin Fulford, and I used to write for Forbes, and got an interview with David Rockefeller, I know about that, from Japan. We'll go ahead and get him on about it and email to showtips@infowars.com, the particular lawsuit filing site where I can actually see that. And where is the lawsuit filed?
It's actually on pacer.gov. It's a, just like a government website.
No, I know what it is.
Yeah, now, I believe the civil lawsuit case is 8500. It's like a civil case number 8500, I believe.
Yeah, but I got to know what court.
Yeah, I'm not.
Look. Just find me the link and send it to me. I really can't comment on it till I've learned more. What do you think about the fact that they're pretty much now unveiling martial law in America?
Warn as many people as I could, my family, you know, and my friends, and they just don't want to hear it. They're in full denial. But I mean, all I can do is just keep going at it, and hopefully they come around.
I hear you. You know, only by people awakening can we turn this around. And a lot of people think if they just stay ignorant, somehow that makes it all go away. I really appreciate your call, sir. Let's start going to another one. We'll come back after break. Mike in Canada, what's on your mind? Oh, and then Perry in Arizona and Vulture and others. Mike, when we come back from break, what do you want to talk about?
Ron Paul, Alex.
We'll start hitting it. What do you want to talk about with Ron Paul?
Well, I've been watching the news not only every day, but every couple hours to see what the new updates are. And I really think that the newsletter thing is going to backfire. He's going to keep gaining.
I tell you what, let me hit the Ron Paul news stack when we come back. I'll go back to you to get your response, more calls. Then I'll get into these Stinger missiles they caught going to China. All right, we're going back to Mike in Canada here in a moment, then Dale, Vulture, Tom, Perry, and others. And then after I take those five or six calls, I'm going to get into the rest of the news, geopolitically, the Stinger missiles that a European country caught trying to be shipped into China. Very suspicious. And more on the big top story. This is the first time ever that it's confirmed. We have a congressional reports. We have Rex 84. We have the Military Commissions Act and the rest of it. But here you have them saying that the military is going to man the camps, that it's for political reasons and for takeover of all facets of government and society, and that the government's listed as blue forces and the American people as the enemy with transponders. And the government pulled this within 1 hour of it going up at Infowars.com. So get this article out to everybody, and we have the Department of Defense whistleblower video interview from the nightly news last night posted in there. Please get this out to everybody. Facebook, Twitter, friends and family, neighbors, police officers, you name it. Before we go back to your calls, fueling our tanks here with all the crew, the webmasters, the filmmakers, everybody. But then more importantly, the books, the videos that we sell wake people up and are cyanide politically to the New World Order. We are carrying the only professionally made modern film on Oklahoma City with the eyewitnesses, the police officers that were threatened, the explosives experts, the people in the Oklahoma City building that saw the feds in there planting bombs, like Jane Graham. A noble lie, you get a citizen rule book with it, and in the Fed, Infowars.com bumper stickers. Available at Infowars.com. Very, very hot video, and I'm glad it is because it is really going to hurt the globalist. You support us and the filmmakers when you buy it at Infowars.com. And then also, you can still get the Alex Jones Everything Special. In fact, that's not even all 18 of them stacked up there. You can get all 18 of my films on DVD for $99.95. That's over 70% off. Give the gift of truth this Christmas and into the new year. And, of course, expanding on that, you can still give a Christmas present this year and support our transmission. Almost 9 years of material, a higher quality audio podcast and video podcast commercial free. All of my films, expanded extras, my ebook, Paul Watson's ebook, and many others. All the expanded extras from films, the nightly news, the daily radio / TV show, Alex Jones Live. Nobody in the fight against the globalists is putting out this much information and having this big of an effect. And it's all at prisonplanet.tv, our own platform. And then when you fund it by being a member for 15 cents a day or get a yearly membership, it's even less right now, 44% off. Or there's a 15-day free trial you can also try at prisonplanet.tv. You fund our operation, which then disseminates it out. You know, people are like, well, why should I be a member for 15 cents a day if you post most of it on YouTube? Well, that's the whole point. It's here. It's our platform, so it's harder to shut down and censor. You see it first. It's all in one spot, but then much of it, the films and things, are put on the web so they can be seen tens of millions of times. So, and we're only beta testing and growing it right now. We've already got TV offers and things, just I'm not ready yet. And we're hiring some more crew thanks to your support, and we're beta testing and reaching millions while we do it. show, prisonplanet.tv or InfoWarsNews.com. Sign up today. And a little secret, just don't use a passcode you use for your bank account or something. Make a easy-to-remember username and passcode. We allow people, six people, to log in with the same username and passcode simultaneously. So you can go give yourself a prisonplanet.tv membership, put it in an e-card, send it to friends and family, or write it in a card. Tell them, go to prisonplanet.tv to see all these great films and nightly news, hardcore information that'll wake you up, or forbidden info is a good way to get them to watch it, because it is. And then give them the username and passcode. So go to prisonplanet.tv or InfoWarsNews.com. Type this in. You can see all the films, the shows, all of it right there. So give yourself the gift of truth, support our transmission, and then share it with a few friends and family. So, I mean, it's a great Christmas gift you can still give, prisonplanet.tv. Okay, let's get into some of this news so I can get back to your calls before our next guest comes on. Here it is, CNN poll, Ron Paul, most popular Republican amongst non-whites. And they dug through thousands of newsletters to find a few things that are kind of flippant. But for mainline Republican stuff, this is nothing. I mean, they say terrible racist stuff all the time, and that's just fine and dandy. This is stuff like, well, when the blacks will stop rioting in South Central when the welfare checks arrive. And then Paul, decades ago, said he didn't write that. Some bad things, you know, that were in the FBI files, who knows if they're true, about probably aren't Martin Luther King, you know, sex with, you know, people or whatever. And that came out 5 years after Paul had voted to put Martin Luther King Day out there. And had given speeches about how he admired Martin Luther King standing up against tyranny. And Paul reportedly got really mad. And I know Ron Paul. I know all the lore. I've known his whole crew, the different crews. I know all the inside baseball. I'll never talk. But a lot of good people. The point is, Ron Paul is the real deal. He doesn't sell out. He doesn't care what people think about him. So if he didn't like Martin Luther King, he would tell you. You understand that? So the point is, it's all bull. But they're using it because they're desperate. They keep saying he can't win. You're not listening to the mind control. Now he's looks like he's going to be in first in New Hampshire and Iowa. He's come up second or first, depending on which poll you see, in Nevada. Those articles are at InfoWars.com. It's meteoric, and it shows how big the awakening is. They keep saying in the news, troops don't like him because he doesn't want to keep the wars going. 70%+ of all presidential donations in both parties, for Obama and the other seven Republicans, go to him. It's all hoaxes. I'm not going to give it attention because it's what they want, and I could definitely win a lawsuit against them. But there is a Dallas publication that I remember 6 months ago implied I was working for the communist Chinese. I mean, it was bizarre. And it's a mainline publication. Today they said, well, Ron Paul hangs out with the known racist who hates black people, Alex Jones. You know, the hardcore racist. And I saw that and I thought, man, I don't have time to sue this guy. But, I mean, if I don't, what next is he going to say? I'm, you know, I support the NDAA bill, getting rid of bestiality or something, and I'm raping possums. I mean, you know, it's that ridiculous. But I looked at every comment. You know, I'm a military in Afghanistan. You can eat bleep. You know, Alex Jones is great and fights racism and blah, 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 and stands up with the little guy. You scum. I mean, and I didn't even have time to read the 50-something comments. I just scanned through them. Everyone was going, you're a yellow journalist, trash. You ought to get sued. Nobody buys you. But, I mean, that's what they're resorting to. Alex Jones works for the Chinese government. Alex Jones hates black people. I mean, what? 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 I mean, they are getting really desperate. Like that headline in CBS News, Alex Jones. You know, Ron Paul likes Alex Jones, and Ron and Alex Jones says they put stuff in the water to make you gay. I read the BBC and Associated Press about gender bending and men having higher estrogen and it changing their different glands in their bodies, confusing sexual activity, but also in every other mammal that is in the food chain now. I mean, that's just, I was reading BBC, but that's how they spin it. I'm reading BBC on air. You can type in right now, gender bending chemicals. Into Google, changing men and women's physiology. Also covered breast cancer increasing. But by the time they're done, the big homophobe says you're gay because they put it in your water. I mean, you know, this is what they do. This is how they attack science, how they attack research. Oh, I saw Bloomberg, CBS, ABC, just literally hundreds that I can't even have time to read all of them, saying Ron Paul is just terrible. He went on Alex Jones' show and said there's a plan to use the military against the people in martial law. It's totally insane. Meanwhile, across the political spectrum, constitutional lawyers say this makes the government a dictatorship and allows them to kill citizens. Just absolute nightmare. And they're all over the news. I mean, you type Alex Jones, Ron Paul in. Just to find these, there's hundreds every day. But then I agree with the caller. I mean, it's going to backfire on them. But see, they just want you to think Ron Paul's been destroyed when they start stealing the elections with the black boxes. But you say, well, then why vote? Why? Because we're going to expose that. And because Ron Paul running exposes them. And if he gets such a big landslide like with Rand Paul and it totally backfires, they won't be able to steal it. They can only steal by small margins from top experts in my own research. We'll get Bev Harris back on if you want from Black Box Voting to go over that. But this is it. And this is how they operate. And as you can see, I told you when he went into first place over the weekend, I said, get ready to hear that he's a Ku Klux Klan Grand Dragon. I mean, get ready to hear he is. And they're like, this crazy racist. I actually saw an article saying this crazy racist Ron Paul thinks that AIDS was created to kill black people. I mean, they even like write crazy oxymoron stuff. It's like, who are these people they hire? And mainstream articles have spelling errors and jumbled stuff all over it. I guess to hire traitors, because a lot of good media people have left the mainstream media. That's another reason there's a brain drain out of the dinosaur media. And that's why the alternative media is now the media. Like that reporter we had on Mr. Hunter yesterday. He's worked for CNN, you know, ABC Nightly News, all of it. And look at him. He's over there making more money, reaching more people, being in front of the camera reporter and writer than he ever did working for them. And he's not compromising. And he said, Alex, they're not the mainstream media anymore. We are. And you know what? That's true. That's why they're panicking. They may sit up there in some $20 million studio and we're in our, you know, $200,000 studio and it's all flashy and they got some person in a $3,000 suit. It doesn't matter. You could dress up a rotten, you know, pig or something in a suit. It's still going to have maggots crawling out its eyes. I'm going to your calls here. I just wanted to go over some of this. Neocon says Ron Paul would appease Hitler and the Nazis. That's an Infowars article. I mean, they're saying he loves Nazis now. Twilight Zone, USA Today story about Ron Paul leading an Iowa headline. Ron Paul is still not in the lead. They admit he's in the lead, but they say that doesn't matter. Just like the governor said, a vote for him isn't real. He's just saying your vote doesn't count. New rules make it possible for Republican establishment to steal nomination from a candidate they don't like. They've changed that now so they can come in and basically steal it. The following rule was adopted by the Republican Party. Any presidential primary caucus, convention, or other meeting held for the purpose of selecting delegates to the national convention, which occurs prior to the first day of April in the year in which the national convention is held, shall provide for the allocation of delegates on a proportional basis. And it goes into how they can then manipulate that. Here's another one. CNN lobs veiled charges of racism at Ron Paul. Got the video up at Infowars.com. It goes on and on and on. Let's go back quickly to Mike and then to Dale. Mike in Canada. Okay, your point's on Ron Paul. Go ahead.
Yeah, even if the first time you ever heard of Ron Paul was looking at his newsletter things, after a couple of links, you'd get right to Prison Planet. You'd get to his answers in the debate, and you would realize, if you know, especially if you're already skeptical of the mainstream news. And I got your shirt that says the answer to 1984 is 1776, and I think Ron Paul is 1776.
You bet he is, and that's why they're pulling out all the stops. I mean, look at Rand. He wasn't connected to a few newsletters they dug out of tens of thousands, and they had people dressed up in hayseed outfits saying racist things and saying they supported him, and it turned out they were on the person he was running against campaign. I mean, they are going to do everything they can. Again, the whole liberal system is about divide and conquer. They're always claiming, oh, we're friends. What did Margaret Sanger say? She said, we got to pose as liberals, we got to hire black leaders so we can kill these weeds. We got to get them aborted. We're going to have to pose as liberals. And she was a confidant of Adolf Hitler. again. I mean, of course, Ron Paul's newsletters had disdain for the welfare class, both corporate and private, and talked about people on welfare and stuff. Again, there's a difference between Ron Paul. You watch him in those different talk show, TV shows he went on that are on YouTube, Morton Downey Jr. and all the rest of them. And people get up and say, how dare you not want to attack other countries and have a giant military and want to legal and legalize drugs? You know, you're a traitor. You know, we need to. And he would get up and say, well, you're fat. You know, maybe the government should come make you not be fat. You know, I mean, Ron Paul used to be really aggressive. Let's go ahead and go to, I appreciate your call, Mike. Let's go to Dale in Kansas. Dale, you're on the air. Oh, listening on XM channel 166. Welcome, sir.
Well, good to be here. I have some information that was handed to me or told to me the other day that surprised me. I have some friends in Arkansas, and they told me that they were talking to somebody, the contractor that is building the Urban Assault Training Center at Fort Chaffee, Fort Smith, Arkansas, as we speak.
Uh-huh.
They're building this thing, and it's an assault center so that they're training people to go into your neighborhoods.
Oh, yes, sir. We have that going back decades where it's American neighborhoods. The role players say, I'm an American, don't take my guns. That's in my police state films. And guys, search Fort Chaffee Urban Assault Center. But yes, they're building giant urban assault centers everywhere, and they have dual use for other countries, but the main focus, and all armed services for at least 5 years have dropped everything and are training even the mechanics and logistics people in urban warfare, mount, and crowd control for America. And yes, sir, it's all public. What did they think of that?
I don't know, when I heard it, it just kind of shocked me because I've listened to you guys for quite some time. But also, Big Red One was moved out of Germany to Kansas for a reason. It is one of the biggest military groups that there is. So back then, this 2 years ago, this is when I started paying attention to...
No. That's why I said yesterday, Big Red One's coming for you. They've been assigned to Brigade Homeland. And obviously, it's much bigger than a brigade, but it's called Brigade Homeland. And 1st Cav and all of it has been assigned, if needed, for direct action against the American people. That's Stars and Stripes in Army Times 3 years ago, sir. Just Google Brigade Homeland Starts U.S. Tour. Guys, type that in. We'll show it to them. They say they want a final domestic security force of 379,000 combat troops to occupy the United States. That's public. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that, but when I was there... this is when they brought them back. They had to expand the base and everything. This thing goes miles. It's not just acres. This thing is miles that they put are housing Big Red One. And also, I wanted to make a point. I was driving a truck, and I used to haul heavy haul, and I went into Fort Camp Shelby, Mississippi. And as I was leaving, I seen one of these FEMA camps. And it just blew me away. The roll barbed wire fence and the whole bit around the top, and they have a gang walk on one end of it, and they have porta potties on one end of it, and it just shook me.
Let me stop you. People ask where there's a FEMA camp. It's in my film, The Takeover. They've got hangars out at the old airport with bolts and chains, fences inside, and porta potties. Stay there. I want you to tell people what you saw, and we can go look on Google and actually pull it up. Tell us the name of the camp again and everything. We'll pull that up. Yeah, a lot of these camps are in Louisiana, Mississippi. All right, my friends, coming up in the next hour, we're going to be joined by Don Browning. He is a retired Oklahoma City police officer, U.S. Marine, Vietnam veteran. He worked the canine unit, was part of the search and rescue team at the Murrah building after the bombing. And this is going to be an amazing interview. Again, it keeps breaking down the information that's in the film, A Noble Lie. I want to go back to your calls, and I haven't even gotten to the news yet on the subject of North Korea, the economy, and the Stinger missiles. But I'll get to them one way or the other, and we'll cover it all in the nightly news tonight. That's one good thing about doing the nightly news. A lot of the most important stuff I never get to on the radio. But right now, let's go back to Dale in Kansas. So tell me the name of the base, where you were, what area of it was. We'll go look on Google Maps. But yeah, that's what the Model Emergency Centers Establishment Act says, is that it's already there at bases, stockade facilities, and that it's set up and waiting for emergencies. And now we have the documents saying the military is going to man them. And we already knew that from some other documents, but this shows it's all been green-lighted right now. And it doesn't mean it has to go there, but it shows that criminals that have gotten control of our government think that they're going to be able to just totally steal everything and have us sign on to all their derivatives and launch all these new wars because they've got control of the government through continuity of government. Dale, you say you were a long-haul truck driver. When did you see this? What did you see?
I've seen this about a year and a half ago. About a year ago. And, this is when I was on the base in Kansas delivering a truck. I moved a lot of these military trucks to the bases.
So what base in Kansas is this again?
Well, the base that I was pointing out is that has the FEMA camp is at Camp Shelby, Mississippi.
Okay, Camp. Camp Shelby. I've seen that on some of the credible lists before. Camp Shelby. A lot of the stuff's there. Camp Shelby, Louisiana. Okay, please continue. Tell me what else you found.
As I was leaving, I've seen this camp. You could tell it was not normal. It's just like a Gestapo prison camp. I mean, it had a real barbed wire fence and everything. And also, while I was up in South Dakota, I was delivering something up there. And I was out in the middle of nowhere. And I like helicopters and stuff like that. And I noticed this helicopter. And it was coming at me. And when it got closer, I paid a little more attention to it. It had no markings on it. All it had was the trilateral symbol on the belly of it, and black as coal. And people, you tell people this stuff, and they don't believe you. I mean, they just don't believe you. And I put my eyes on this stuff every time I hear about it.
What about Camp Shelby, Mississippi? From my memory, that's a pretty big base. What area is this in with the classic stockade and the barbed wire facing in?
Okay, it's on the, as I was leaving, I saw it. So it was on an exit route out of the base. So if you'll look it up, it's on the outside. It's not on the outside of the base, but it's as you're leaving the base of the exits. You know, it's not on the entrance of the
Describe
base.
Describe it more. Describe why you knew it was a FEMA camp.
Oh, you can tell. I mean, with the real barbed wire fence and all it had was tents in there, little tents, and a whole bunch of porta potties on one end of it. And then it had, what really shook me up was when I saw the gangwalk up on top of, up at the top of the fence.
Sure, it's got an area for guards to walk around with shotguns.
Right, just like you'd see in a prison camp. And that's what really shook me up, and that has always stuck in my head. And then, of course, I watch this stuff every day, and I listen to you and stuff, and I listen to other things. And you all was talking about the buildup of police. Well, Interstate 70, I traveled it every day across Missouri, and there has been a buildup of police, state troopers, county sheriffs, everything. I would say it's probably tripled in buildup.
Oh, yeah, they're building up for the bankers to kill America, and the cops, a lot of them can't help it. They're simple-minded. They're like, well, I get the power because I'm a good guy, and things are collapsing, and we'll just have to take their guns then. God bless you, my friend. All right, we've got an amazing guest coming up. Actually, two amazing guests coming up, joining us via video Skype in the next segment. Oklahoma City investigators, one of them who was there when the bombing, in the aftermath. That is coming up in the next segment. Also, in some of the other news, Obama prepared to attack military action. Again, Obama prepared to take military action against Iran. Dennis Ross, a big Obama advisor, says if Obama draws the conclusion that certain kind of steps should be taken against Iran, he'll take them. Yeah, because he's completely blackmailed and controlled. Here's another one. Dozens of people die in roadside bombs in Iraq right as the United States begins to officially pull out. But it has all those advisors and embassy staff and mercenaries there. And Tony Cartolucci, writer for Infowars.com, has a big article out. In a move that almost defies belief, it is so brazen and hypocritical, many will not believe it, no matter how many State Department officials confirm it. The U.S. has been guarding a terrorist training camp inside Iraq with U.S. troops and is planning to relocate them, possibly in a freshly abandoned U.S. military base in Iraq, while D.C. lobbyists work feverishly to have them delisted, armed, and sent to conduct terrorist operations in Iran. And this is what 2-3 weeks ago, Steve Pachinik, former State Department official and terrorism expert, talked about. The MEK, which is an admitted real terrorist group, is basically working for the U.S. government. I mean, what group isn't? Because this isn't the U.S. government, ladies and gentlemen. It's offshore megabanks that are totally ruthless and hire criminal mercenary groups to stage terror attacks all over the world, to finance other terror groups, to stage bombings here in the U.S., to do it all so the system can take our liberties and freedoms and pose as our saviors. And it is so incredibly dangerous on that front. Looking at Korea and China, ex-President Carter sends condolences to Kim Jong-un. And that only props these crazy hereditary dictators up. I understand they've got to have somebody who can diplomatically talk to these people. But why did Donald Rumsfeld, as the head of the big Swiss company back in the mid-1990s, transfer the reactor systems so North Korea could have nuclear weapons? Continuing, Finland finds Patriot missiles on China-bound ship. Mark this, fireworks. See, while you're busy being told to be scared to death of Al-Qaeda under the table, 10,000-plus missiles, 2,000-plus that are high-tech, surface-to-air missiles, were basically given to Al-Qaeda and allowed to keep them when Al-Qaeda was given control of Libya by NATO. And that's on record. That's even mainstream news. Pull it up. Pull up London Telegraph headlines like Al-Qaeda flag now flies over Libya. Al-Qaeda being sent in to fight Syrians. Al-Qaeda works for the globalists that have hijacked this country. People are like, but why would they have them attack us? So they can take all our liberties, blame Iraq that had nothing to do with it, and invade them. Now they're blaming Iran for 9/11. Next, they'll blame you, or maybe Santa Claus for it. Everybody but who's involved. The Finnish authorities have impounded an Isle of Man flagship bound for China with undeclared missiles and explosives. British or U.S. government, they're always doing this. Police are questioning the crew of the MS Thor Liberty after what were described as 69 Patriot anti-missile missiles were found on board. Yeah, you can also use a Patriot to shoot aircraft down all day long. Oh, but they've been saying Al-Qaeda must have stingers. Left over from the 80s, give all your rights up. Continuing here, Interior Minister Pavi Rasin said the missiles were marked fireworks. The MS Thor Liberty was docked in Finnish port after leaving Germany last week. Dock workers became suspicious after Mr. Napolitano told them to be. I'm joking. After finding explosives poorly stored on open pallets, and missiles were then found in containers marked fireworks. More on this coming up, but first, our guest. All right, we are continuing our series of interviews to document what really happened in Oklahoma City on the record this week, and I'll do it next week and into the new year, at least once or twice a week, because there's so many amazing people that are interviewed, and then some that aren't, in this film, A Noble Lie, Oklahoma City, 1995. Jane Graham, the head of HUD, who was in the building and saw known feds planting bombs. She didn't know what they were at the time, big gray sticks of butter. They said they were with the telephone company. You've got the inventor of the neutron bomb saying clearly that there were explosives inside the building, the newscast admitting it as well. You've got the former head of Air Force Weapons Development breaking it down. The mother of Police Officer of the Year, Terry Yeaky, the first to respond, who saw the feds running around involved. They, of course, killed him. It's an amazing film, and you need to show it to police and military especially, because the Obama administration has put out, what, three different memos saying a new Oklahoma City would really help them. They don't even veil it. They don't say we're going to do it. They just say it would really help us, and if there's a new one, we're going to blame the right wing. And barring that, we're in deep trouble. And I see all of it moving towards that. Now, our exposure of it may stop them. And I've been talking a lot more in the last year about Oklahoma City again, as you know. I mean, I made a 40-minute film within a film. And I made a lot of films that are like 3 hours long, like Road to Tyranny, that's really three different subjects. The history of terror and the New World Order, stage terror, then Oklahoma City, the first World Trade Center, and then into 9/11. Now, this video is available at Infowars.com, and it supports the filmmakers and, of course, my operation when you get it. But bottom line, get it. Air it on Access TV. Have local showings in your area. Just like with my films, get my films. You're authorized to make copies of my films. I want all of my my videos out there to everybody because this is a life and death situation. I mean, you watch my police state films, you'll understand what's now unfolding. Now, let's stop right there. Don Browning is a retired Oklahoma City police officer, former U.S. Marine and Vietnam veteran. Don worked in the K-9 unit and was part of the search and rescue team at the Murrah building after the bombing. And we're going to go through some important questions. And riding shotgun with him is Holland van den Nieuwenhof. He is a native of Oklahoma and served as a rifle squad leader in Marine Corps. Holland decided to get off the bench one day and started writing and passing out leaflets that exposed government corruption and cover-ups. These efforts led him to collaborate with the Oklahoma Bombing Investigation Committee in their efforts to uncover the truth behind the OKC bombing. He was instrumental in the formation of the first low-power FM station in Oklahoma to fight the globalist. I had that part that focused on truth and freedom issues, carrying my show, of course. Holland engages in a variety of endeavors to spread awareness in his community. Absolutely, and fight the criminals that have taken this country over. So both these gentlemen join us, good American patriots and Marines fighting the tyranny. And from my memory, Don, I've never talked to you, but I believe you were one of the guys got threatened, too. We've talked to the other guys, some people off record, Department of Defense, bomb disposal, you name it, where they said, don't ask questions about the bombs, or we know where your daughter goes to school. Just incredible. But Don Browning, great to have you joining us via video Skype today, and we appreciate your courage coming on air.
Thank you, sir.
You know, I could babble all day, but why are you here? What did you see? What is most important for us to understand? And Holland, you can, you know, pretty much, because you know him well and have studied Oklahoma even more than I have, where do you think we should go first?
Well, we can start with the day of the bombing, of course, when Don responded, and the get into the evacuations that were later denied that they took place, and the explosives that were found inside the building. Don, you were the first to respond, one of the first to respond to the bombing, right?
Yes, sir.
And you and your dog, Gunny, right?
Correct.
And one of the main points of the movie, what we try to emphasize is the fact that there were several evacuations after the initial bombing that they were later denied. They said they were false alarms or hoaxes. But in Anobali, we have videotape from a sheriff's deputy taken during one of the evacuations that shows the ATF pulling weapons and plastic explosives out of the building. No one has seen this tape. Well, some people have, but it's been passed down hand to hand. We digitally remastered the tape. No one has seen it in this quality, and it's never seen widespread publicity.
Yeah, by the way, that's the kind of stuff that's in this film, is many of your team have been on this for over a decade. I mean, this is a obsession to get the murder of these children out. I mean, that's why it's so important.
Well, this is my hometown. I grew up in Oklahoma City. And once I started realizing what had happened, I felt it was my duty to expose the truth. I saw that no one else, well, I mean, other people were doing it, but I wanted to really get the story out to the people. We found a team. We got a good director's team, production, editing, and we made the movie as the best way to get the message out to the masses.
Exactly. And it's the only, you know, well-done testament in modern times. So let's get into why Don is such an incredible witness and such an amazing expert.
Well, Don, you were actually in the building in the canine rescue unit, and during one of the evacuations, what were they doing during the evacuations?
As far as the initial evacuation, we're just trying to determine the location of the victims, really trying to determine how to remove some of the debris. At about 11 o'clock that first morning, we were halted for the first time. Ordered out of the building for no other reason than they wanted to secure the building. On a limited access, we were allowed back in. In fact, worked for a little bit in the area with Dana Bradley, who's had her leg amputated, being pinned in the building. Worked in that area for the next little bit, and then finally we were ordered out by the U.S. Marshals. We were sequestered pretty much on the south side of the Murrah building in the courtyard area. Was kind of held at bay, told that we'd be allowed to go back in and search, but there were files that were so critical to the government that until those files were found, there would be no more rescue or recovery.
And there were people still inside?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. There was a gentleman that was apparently he was already deceased, but he was still laying bleeding out on the south face of the building.
And you could see that, and they wouldn't let you recover?
Yes, sir.
because they had to recover documents.
Correct.
What's important about that, Alex, is that that maybe one of the reasons that this happened is that their priority was on the documents for some reason, recovering those documents to the detriment of the people who were trapped inside and died. As the Oklahoma City Police Chief said on camera, that we lost people because of the evacuations. We lost people because of this.
And we have all the newscasts where the governors, they found more bombs. They're taking them out. That's another device the bomb squad has. And here's Don Browning, who was there with the dog and was a police officer and also a Marine veteran. So just amazing to see what was going on. We only have those newscasts. What did you see with them and the reported bombs?
There was two different incidents where they claimed that they had determined that there was a secondary explosives device. They quarantined that area. I did not actually see them remove the device from the building. It was more to the northwest corner of the building, from what I understood, in the debris. And I was still yet on the south side, close to the elevator shafts.
But these evacuations did take place. We have affidavits from first responders saying that there were at least two other bombs discovered in the rubble, that one of these bombs was timed to go off 10 minutes after the first explosion. This is a typical terrorist tactic, is to have at least two bombs, one to attract responders and the second bomb to inflict even greater casualties. So this could have been worse. That's a bad thing about Oklahoma City. As bad as it was, it could have been much, much worse.
Now, going through some of these questions, what really got you asking questions, and I'm going from memory and secondhand, Don, how did things progress with the feds telling you to get out of there? Were you ever threatened like some of the other police were?
Yes, sir. At one point that morning, I was advised that we were going to be arrested by federal marshals if we did not leave the immediate area. Like I said, we didn't want to be a hindrance, didn't really understand what was going at that point. So we did withdraw and stayed sequestered there on the courtyard area in hopes that we were going to be allowed to go back in. And interestingly, we were advised at that point that no police dog would be allowed back in the building, that there would be the search and rescue dogs would be coming in from private sources.
So they couldn't trust the Oklahoma City police, but they'd have some special people coming. I want to get into all the technicals and the horse patrol being mobilized before the bombing and what Terrence Yeaky saw, and you know, really the key points here with you, sir. But bottom line, from 16 years of researching this, being in it, and what you know and seeing this film, as a police officer, as an investigator, as a veteran with a lot of different perspectives and wisdom, what do you believe really happened with Oklahoma City?
I personally believe that there was a secondary explosion. I don't know whether it was sympathetic to the truck explosion and that it was just armament that was stored in the Murrah building. But due to the destructive nature of what occurred, in particularly in closer to the east side of the building on the south side, where there was just total destruction, I do believe that there was at least a sympathetic explosion.
Exactly. The damage pattern to the building, when you look at it, is asymmetrical to the truck bomb. It's offset from the major damage to the building. The crater is offset from the major bite, as we show in the movie.
It's on the other end of the building from it, and we can see it right behind you there. The truck bomb was basically where your shoulder is, Holland. You're a shoulder that's facing inward towards Don. And then if you see back in the corner where the earphone is, where Don is, that's where you had columns blown off at the base. And Parton says that it was specifically charges on those columns.
Yes, we interviewed General Parton. I believe one of the first interviews anyone's ever given him on video. And he was a former head of Air Force Weapons Development. He spent 20 years blowing things up for the military and conducting bomb damage analysis. This is his job. He saw what happened in Oklahoma City. He saw the damage. He knew it could not be an ammonium nitrate truck bomb. So he analyzed, did his famous Parton report, which concluded that the columns inside the Murrah building were destroyed due to Brazant's damage, meaning that there were contact explosives on the columns that the truck bomb was not the sole cause of destruction that day. That truck bomb did do a lot of damage, and it was powerful. But what it would have done to the Murrah building was basically blown in all the windows and damaged the facade, and certainly would
have
killed.
Well, that's what you see in Saudi Arabia with trucks full of military grade, is it just blows the facade off and blows things through the building, sometimes both sides, but the columns are right there.
The supporting columns were there, and the Murrah building was constructed in the 70s with bomb resistance in mind, because there was a lot more political instability going on in the post-60s era back then.
Yeah, communist bombing stuff.
Yeah, exactly. It was a federal building. It was designed with bombs in mind. And those columns would not have failed due to a truck bomb. That is an impossibility. In fact, the American Society of Civil Engineers was not even allowed on site to do their own analysis. They did an analysis, but they were kept 200 feet back.
Well, that's another issue. They blow up the wreckage, more than half the building standing there. They act super suspicious. They threaten people. Hoppy Heidelberg, police officers, doctors that show up. The ATF's in their full gear like a minute after. As a police officer, Don, watching them act so suspicious, I mean, what does that look like to you? And what did other police officers tell you off record their view was on this?
One of the bomb officers was describing to me one of what he thought was one of the secondary devices, and he said that he had a clock real similar to it sitting on his desk, which was just a three-road stick of dynamite with an alarm clock stuck on it, just kind of a decoration type thing. And I really was serious about trying to convince me that that's what they thought was a secondary device. And we got a little more involved in our conversations, and he said that they did find nitrous bottle end caps, other things that would help accelerate the info bomb.
Exactly. One of the stories they propagated to cover one of the evacuations, that three different bomb squads had mistaken a toy alarm clock as a real bomb, which is ludicrous, and no reason to evacuate the entire building before that could actually be concluded and ascertained on the site. You wouldn't evacuate the building before you actually determine that it was a bomb, especially because there's people inside bleeding out.
But you've got pieces of the building blown the opposite direction away from the truck bomb on top of the building across the street.
Exactly. That truck bomb exploded on the north side of the building, yet north of that, across the street, there are chunks of the Murrah building that somehow transported themselves against the blast wave of the truck bomb. And that's the thing about this whole story, is that it is a conclusive fact that truck bomb was not the sole cause of agent. Yet, the cover-up has gone into effect. Everyone on the scene knows that the truck bomb was not the sole cause of destruction. And we see how the mainstream media and the government is able to manipulate a story, take what is actually reality, which is that there were bombs inside the building that did most of the damage, and change it to something else, destroy the crime scene while there were still bodies inside. A month after the bombing, they demolished that building, and there were still a number of people inside, deceased persons, of course, but they were in such a rush that they wouldn't even recover the bodies. Don was there for that.
Right. Yeah, we did pull the, in fact, we had located one of the female victims that we had to leave inside the building on the night of the 4th, and the building was pretty unstable in that area. But rather than trying to shore anything up, we were removed. The building was brought down, and we were allowed to go back in the 29th of May and research the area, and did locate that lady along with one of her female companion workers and another gentleman that had died in the blast.
Wow, I know this is hard to talk about. A lot of key questions we haven't gotten to yet here. Don Browning, retired Oklahoma City police officer, canine rescue handler, was there right after one of the first people there on the scene, a former U.S. Marine, Vietnam veteran as well. Could you tell us, you've told us about the marshals threatening the police. What about FBI threatening you specifically?
Within the weeks that followed after the actual occurrence, FBI agents were assigned to set up a communication station at the Oklahoma City Police K-9 and Equine Center. And they were in and out of our office through the day. Of course, we were supposed to just conduct business as normal, and they were still concluding their investigations, but was told more than once or twice of agents in the area that people like my wife and I would have ended up dead by not going along with what we need to be true.
Wow, so you're a decorated Vietnam veteran, police officer, one of the heroes that responded when there could have been other bombs and was thought there were other bombs, and the FBI agents in the police office are telling you, do what you're told or you and your wife are dead. And you're saying this on record here, sir.
Yes, sir.
Please elaborate for the millions of listeners exactly what happened. And if you'd like to name names, I'm not afraid of these people.
As far as names, I really don't know. I do know there was an agent, Jim Height, that had contacted me that was concerned about the health of the dogs right about the same time. His story was that the building had been sprayed with an agent similar to Agent Orange to try to slow decomposition. And that there was supposedly was complaints that the odor of the decomp was becoming an issue to the surrounding area in the community. Again, there was just different things that occurred that just absolutely defied my understanding why they would use something such as Agent Orange without warning us of what they were doing.
But I mean, separately, did they phone call you? I mean, did an agent in the hall say, hey, you better do what we're told or you and your wife are dead? I mean, how would they talk to you?
No, it was person to person in the hallway there in the office there at the canine center.
So they'd say, do what you're told or you and your wife are dead.
Right.
And what did you say to that?
It wasn't too much. I'd say I kind of yell right. And I was not. At that time, was really not in a good mood to hear their crap. I had a major from our department that was telling me that I needed to find new friends, and he thought I was part of the militia.
Okay, so they're intimidating you, they're isolating you, and then they're threatening you and your wife in a hallway. I mean, it's so unbelievable. You probably had one of the perpetrators right there with you. Oh my God.
Well, I mean, that's one of the thing about the one of the things about this. When you see the behavior of the federal agents on the scene and afterwards, it makes you question what their mission is entirely, because they were not responding in a professional manner. They pulled people back to pull off the videotapes. Don, you witnessed that.
Yes, I watched while we were being sequestered there in the courtyard. I did watch agents with FBI raid jackets on, removing cameras from video cameras from the corners of the Murrah building.
Tapes that we've never seen. Those cameras would have recorded everything that happened in front of the Murrah building. Mm-hmm. You know, if we are wrong and they want to prove it, you know, if you can show the tape that shows McVeigh getting out of that truck and that truck causing the damage to that building, I'll go home and I'll never talk to you.
Well, they've declared national security. Some good FBI agents have gone public, as you know, in the LA Times 9 years ago, and they said they've seen the tapes. There's 20-something of them, and it does show McVeigh with a bunch of other men, and that's why the government doesn't want it released.
Exactly, and the Secret Service timeline records that when they looked at the tape, that there were suspects exiting the truck 3 minutes after it was parked. Plural, that means multiple suspects, but to this day, they insist McVeigh was the only person who drove that truck up. Don Browning mentioned Dana Bradley earlier. During a trial of McVeigh in Denver, they could only produce one witness who could place McVeigh in Oklahoma City. That was Dana Bradley. She lost her children and her mother and her leg in the bombing. She gained some notoriety because she was trapped in the rubble and they had to amputate on site. Under cross-examination, she admitted that when she was in the Social Security office waiting in line, she saw that Ryder truck pull up. Tim McVeigh got out of one side, and a suspect, another man, got out of the other side. Under cross-examination, admitted this. And then the federal prosecutors tried to drag her name through the mud and say that she had misremembered the day, that it was another day that she had lost her entire family and her leg, that she saw that Ryder truck pull up with two people. It's just ludicrous. And insulting.
Unbelievable. We have Holland Vanden Nieuwenhof, investigator, filmmaker, and Don Browning, Oklahoma City police officer, U.S. Marine Vietnam veteran, was one of the first to be there. We'll talk about Terrence Yeaky and his murder, another police officer that responded on the other side. Folks, I don't like risking my life to expose these people, but we've got to. They're getting ready to do it again. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Oklahoma City's real simple. The ATF even got a Ryder truck and practiced blowing it up a few months before in New Mexico. That even came out on Discovery Channel. They were embarrassed that they wanted to get anti-terror funding and laws passed that they've now gotten through, of course, in 93. So they torched Waco. That blew up in their face. And so then they carried out Oklahoma City to blame it on domestic groups and on the states' rights movement. And to make Bill Clinton look like a victim, he could demonize talk radio and conservatives. And I mean, it was so obvious by their instant response in minutes. It was all scripted. And I remember being in Austin and people were mailing the tapes down and putting them on Access TV. That's why I went down and got an Access TV show in 95, was watching the soap opera every week of the tapes mailed down to patriots from Oklahoma City and the other patriots locally putting it on, with the bombs coming out of the building and General Parton at press conferences and Hoppy Heidelberg being threatened and, you know, all this stuff going on. And then you find out that so many of these other events have been staged, and then to have these police officers killed and threatened, and Department of Defense people that were there for bomb disposal threatened. We know where your daughter lives, where your daughter goes to school. Again, ladies and gentlemen, you can say, oh, well, I would, you know, punch him in the nose or whatever. But imagine being in a police headquarters and FBI guys come over when you're walking down the hall and say, you and your wife are going to get it if you don't stop what you're doing. I mean, wow. I mean, why would an FBI agent do that? Unless they were involved. I mean, you're now threatening to kill cops and their wives. That's who runs this government. And the same crew is in charge now. The guy that's the attorney general, he was deputy attorney general then. And in lawsuits, his emails and memos have come out where he's like, April 20th, we got to get to Oklahoma and this is D-Day. These are quotes. And cover this up. Cover what up? Cover what up?
Happened in Oklahoma City. Eric Holder was in charge of the investigation for the Justice Department. He managed the investigation, later in charge of the Trentadue cover-up, now Attorney General of the United States, and now he has Gunwalker all over him. This man has killed thousands of people. That's in the headlines now. Why is it so hard to believe that an operation in 1995 killed 168 people?
Yes, sir. That's a good point, Mr. Browning. Again, retired Oklahoma City police officer, was one of the first to respond. I mean, that's a false flag staged event right there, where they weren't just letting them get sold at gun shops. That was the cover. We now know 18-wheelers into Mexico, and in the federal cases, drugs back in. I mean, Eric Holder's just a mob boss.
Well, you were talking about, you had Hoppy Heidelberg on this show earlier this week. You were talking about the threats he received. What's interesting about that is that the FBI agent who threatened Hoppy Heidelberg is named John Hersley. John Hersley was basically the FBI's representative to the prosecution during the trial. John Hersley was there with his partner threatening Hoppy Heidelberg with a gun if he kept on talking about what had happened behind closed doors at the grand jury that indicted McVeigh and Nichols and others unknown. John Hersley is now the go-to guy for the History Channel and whoever else wants to do an apology for the official story. John Hersley is there in a suit and tie with the American flag behind him, representing the United States government. That man is a thug. He threatens people with guns, and he's on TV trying to explain the official story. In fact, he wrote a book, Ghost wrote a book about the bombing, about the official story, and the title is called Simple Truths. Simple Truths, which is always what the noble lie is cloaked in, a simple truth.
Don, what were you looking into that made FBI agents threaten not only you, but to kill your wife?
I was trying to follow up. I had a lot of citizens that was calling, giving information. I was trying to follow through with different tidbits of information I was getting, even from persons such as Janie Carverdale and Glenn and Wilburn and his wife. I felt obligated as a police officer that we should be looking into all those things, and they were pretty frustrated that. For the most part, they were being ignored or being told it didn't matter. It was similar to like Dana Bradley that we mentioned earlier. I was called into the U.S. Attorney's office and was questioned as to what she said to me the entire time that I was near her. I wanted to know every if and but every I, every T. She was groaning. She was in pain. There was no noticeable conversation that came from her. But
they wanted to know what she'd seen and what she'd told you.
Exactly.
And there's a woman pinned under giant girders who lost her leg, and they're wanting to know, what did she say? What did she say? So as a police officer, you're saying the feds were acting super guilty.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It was, I was told at the time that they were going to have to refute what she was saying, and apparently she was delirious due to her injuries and her losses.
I bet. You know, she'd lost family members again in there. Incredible. Let's talk about Terrence Yeaky. Tell us about this gentleman who was one of the first people along with you to respond, you know, running into the building that had just been devastated, and then what happened to him, why this is so important.
Well, Terry, first off, was a remarkable young man. He was very likable. I did not work with him shoulder to shoulder in our assignments at the police department. However, I did work a lot of extra jobs and security work with him. Not good friends, but friends enough that, especially after the bombing, I would always tease Terry about, man, you're my hero. You're just my hero.
Yeah, well, he made the cover of Newsweek.
Right, yeah.
Because he hauled a lot of people out, right?
Yes, sir. And Terry, bless his heart, right off the bat was concerned because there were so many FBI and ATF agents on the scene, even when he drove up.
Terrence, you drive up and there's feds and their gear running around everywhere, what, 30 seconds after?
Yeah, he showed up just minutes after. Terrence Yeaky was the first officer to respond. He pulls up, and there are FBI agents on scene. The FBI headquarters is 5 miles away. They have no business. Why are ATF agents and FBI agents at the scene of the bombing, sitting there watching what's going on, when the first officer to respond pulls up?
Well, they were proud of their work. I mean,
well, there was an operation going on.
Yeah, blowing up some kids in a daycare. That's what tough guys do.
Well, Don, you were given privy information about a surveillance operation by the FBI that was going on at the time, right? Concerning the vehicle description?
Yeah, they always claim that when it happens, it was a sting went bad, yeah.
Well, no, quite interestingly, the morning of the bombing, as I was in route downtown, they were simulcasting a three-vehicle description along with the seven Persian males that were supposedly occupying these vehicles that they had left on the interstate systems from the Murrah building area. And surprisingly, we were told that these vehicles were still under surveillance and continued to progress.
The FBI said that?
Yes.
So the FBI told the police that they were watching the suspects.
But the building blows up and they don't stop the suspects.
But no, please don't understand. This supposedly was afterwards. This was supposedly the suspects of the bombing itself.
Sure, yeah.
That went on through all the morning up until about 1:30. At that point, I had an opportunity to speak to one of the FBI agents that had kind of slowed to take a break, and asked him what the status was, and was informed at that point that that was disinformation, that it was designed to throw the press off, and was nothing but disinformation. I became very irate at the time, and that they were broadcasting this to a 5-state area. It was not only throwing all the media off, it was throwing every cop in the world off as well, if this was fictitious information.
Well, the perps want to throw folks off. So Terrence Yeaky pulls up a minute or so after, and it's crawling with FBI and ATF, and then what happens next?
Well, he goes ahead and works with the recovery. From what I understand, over the next few days after that incident, he had started to complain to Janet Reno and to others about the treatment that he was getting from the FBI agents, and also from the fact that there were so many of them on the scene. It was quite concerning to him. We talked a little bit about some of his concerns and some of my concerns, but we both were still I'd say it still wasn't really that trustworthy, even of one another. It was a time where you really didn't know who you could trust completely or not.
Sure, if you're not a completely unconscious moron, you pull up and it's like watching a guy run out of a bank with a mask on and a bag of money. You know who you pull up and there's feds running around in their full gear right after it happens. You're like, well, what's going on? They're like, oh, nothing. In fact, there were doctors and people there who they would say, patch me up. I was up on the ninth floor. And the doctors are like, well, there's nothing wrong with you. You weren't up there. And he's like, well, you're going to end up dead if you don't do what I say. I mean, this death threatening. I just can't imagine people just, I'm a fed, and I'm going to death threat police and everybody else because I'm God. I mean, it sounds like a bunch of lunatics.
Yeah, it was interesting, like I said, with Terry in that. When Terry died, he was not treated as a normal police officer. There was no autopsy performed. He of course was viewed by a medical examiner, and they did complete the death certificate and follow up reports. But no autopsy, nothing to describe why the injuries that Terry had suffered. Where they came from or what type of injuries those were.
But we do have that. What, thanks to Colonel Craig Roberts going from memory, we do have the basic medical examiner's drawings, and of course you guys have talked to some of the witnesses and some of the sheriff's department I know from the county over that did show up reportedly, and so go over this in detail. The feds are like digging dirt up. Terrence Yeaky's obviously been tortured. I mean, as a police officer, go over what happened to him.
Terry had numerous lacerations on his wrists, across his elbows, on both arms. He had a long cut that began just underneath his right ear and extended past his Adam's apple. There was another small hesitation cut on the left side of his throat.
You think that was when they were just threatening him to slit his throat to get the answers of where the stuff was?
Well, I was told by the district attorney when I went to the grand jury that it was due to EMTs trying to save Terry's life.
Oh. And, of course, he'd been dead. Well, I mean, let's go over. I mean, let's talk about how he died because, I mean, he was telling his partner, I got feds behind me last time he was heard from, right?
Terry was transporting documents and evidence that he had collected. He called his friend. Another police officer said, let's meet for dinner. As soon as I shake these feds who are following me, we'll meet. Terry went to El Reno. Terry grew up in El Reno, Oklahoma. He knew all the back roads. And his car is found on federal property. El Reno has a federal prison. The reason the federal government was able to come in and take control of the investigation was that his body was found on federal land.
Yeah, so they did that again. Wow.
Exactly. And when he had handcuff marks on his wrists, there was mud packed into his wounds. There was no way he could have drug himself through the mud a mile and a half through creeks and trees while bleeding and then decide to shoot himself at an angle at the top of his head and coming out the lower part of his jaw.
Sure, so now, let me ask this. Cops, everybody shows up. I mean, you talk about the county shows up, and they said, yeah, the feds were covering it up, and the police all just stand around, and, well, they killed him. Because all the police we've talked to, yeah, they killed him. And I guess that's just what feds are God. They want to kill cops. Go ahead, you know.
Well, that's what was interesting to me at that point was anytime we had a police officer involved in an automobile accident or anything outside of the city limits, the city still sent investigative officers out to investigate the accident, if nothing else to supplement whatever agency did do the investigation. With Terry, basically our agency just washed their hands of it and turned it completely over to the FBI. And
yeah, whenever a police officer dies in Oklahoma City, there's always an autopsy. A couple years ago, a police officer died in a car wreck, and there was no question about why he had died. He was on duty. He was responding to a call. They still performed an autopsy, yet they find a police officer just a couple years before in a field, cut, bleeding.
A year after he's the hero of Oklahoma City, yeah, on the cover of Newsweek and police officer of the year.
Shot in the head, and they do not perform an autopsy. Once again, it does not hold up to scrutiny at all.
Well, who was this police chief? I mean, who is either purely wicked or the biggest coward on the planet?
He was a Chief Gonzalez was from the Dallas-Fort Worth area. He had been on the Dallas PD prior to his being hired with Oklahoma City. He really didn't have connections to Oklahoma City and would frequently leave for extended weekends to go play golf in Dallas. really never did feel like he was a portion of our department at all.
So he was just a placeholder.
Yes, sir.
He was also a young patrolman in Dallas on November 22nd, 1963.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
So he's a very trustworthy person.
I don't know if he had any involvement with that, but that is his background.
Kind of like Dan Rather. Okay, continuing here. There's a lot of other points here that are important. Can you tell us about the horse patrol being mobilized for crowd control prior to the bombing?
Yes, sir. Again, that was one of the things that kind of surprised me. The horse patrol basically, through the week, did not patrol any area. They maybe once or twice, one or two of the officers would saddle up and they would go into the stockyards area.
Horses are for special events, right? I mean, big crowds.
Sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Interestingly, they had, anytime we did work a big event, they would have the county reserve would also come in and supplement the with horses and manpower, and they would act out together. The morning of the bombing, the horse patrol was going downtown in force. They claim they really don't know why they were going down there. It wasn't necessary for crowd control. They was going down to work the downtown area. This was about a week before what we were scheduled to have an art festival. That would mandated that they would have had to be there. So it was they were coming up on some time frame where a lot of overtime was going to be required. So it was kind of surprising that they would just out of the blue decide to gather and go downtown to do this quite large horse patrol. There was probably somewhere between 8 to 10 riders and horses that were en route.
Was that order to settle up given before the bombing?
Yes, sir. They were actually leaving and would have already been downtown by the time the bomb went off, according to one of the supervisors, had it not been for one of our officers was slow in getting ready, and they were just pulling out of the K-9 Equine Center when the bomb detonated.
All right, when we come back, I'm going to ask you, what do the rank-and-file Oklahoma City police think 16, 17 years after this tragedy that's been used to butcher the Bill of Rights and Constitution? This is another super disgusting thing we have to discuss, but, I mean, it's only going to get worse if we don't wake up to false flag terror. Don Browning, retired Oklahoma City police officer, one of the first on the scene, is our guest, along with one of the filmmakers, Holland, Vanden Nieuwenhof. I'm Alex Jones. You know, I am a father. I have three great children. I love my wife. I love life. And I've been threatened. I've been beat up before when I was exposing the Waco situation and the trial and bullhorning the judge. And they sent five guys, four of them attacked me, beat me up pretty bad. But I beat them up, too, in a parking lot telling me, shut up. They broke my nose and punched me. I mean, and that. But you know what? That was when I knew how real this was. Okay? And the federal government is run by a bunch of criminals now, who just think that we're here to be doormats and our property, our children belong to them. And we can beat these people. But let me tell you, living in denial, this isn't about just criticizing the government and we come up with fanciful tales. This is a police officer who was there and saw all this, who had FBI agents threaten to kill him and his wife. Other cops got killed. Doctors got killed. Grand jurors got threatened. These are FBI comes to your house with guns and says, shut your mouth. Then other people come and say, you're dead if you keep this up. This is what they do. I mean, and somebody's got to call them on it. Somebody's got to realize it. That this country, I mean, they're now announcing they're going to use the military against the American people. We get the Department of Defense contact. Joe Joseph calls us and says, have you seen this? It's on the federal government's own website. And then they pull it, where they call the American people the enemy, the red group, and the government is the blue group. And, I mean, the general public is listed as the enemy. That's not the American government. You get a police officer's questioning, and they go, we think you're in a militia, implying they were involved in it because they're asking questions. You cannot control reality by being delusional. You can't just say, oh, this couldn't be true, like the Austin police chief said 2 weeks ago when I was talking to him privately. And I looked in his eyes, and I could tell he's not stupid. He says he listens to the show. He knows. And he said some things privately to me. I'll get him in more trouble not saying what he said. He didn't say it's off record. He's just like, yeah, I'll probably never get promoted above Austin because I'm even on your show, but I don't care anymore. Alex, I know you're a good guy. I'll see you later. But the point is, that's not enough. I can tell our police chief's a real person. You've got to choose what side you're on. In closing, Don Browning, and people can get the film, which people have given their lives for you to be able to know this information, NobleLie@Infowars.com. Get it out to everybody. In the 2 or 3 minutes we've got left with you and Holland, Band and Nieuwenhof, what do the other police officers around you say? Or, I mean, do they just give in to the big lie?
It's interesting. It's kind of a combination of both, where some are literally scared to death. Terry Yeaky's good buddy at one point met me shortly after Terry had died, told me that I was on the right track. Please keep on pushing. Terry deserved that, but he couldn't help me. And officers, for the most part, do, or at least at this point, starting to finally come out with the feelings and emotions that they did not eat the story. They didn't battle it, but they did not eat the information that was handed out to us.
Why didn't you guys get together and circle the wagons and say, we got guns too, you want to threaten us?
At the time of the circling of the wagons, I don't think we felt like there was enough of us to circle even half of the circle. So
Well, there wasn't at the Alamo either, but we appreciate your incredible courage, sir. But sometimes it takes some of us getting wiped out so other people can see, and then that's when we get the victory.
What was interesting, I'll share a comment that Stephen Jones made when I was up at McVeigh's trial. Jones came to me. He had been part of the Roger Dale Stafford defense team when Roger Dale Stafford had committed the Sirloin Stockade murders. And I had testified in that case as well. And I shook my head as I was walking up towards him coming back to the hotel. And he stopped me and he says, you know, if only 4 or 5 Oklahoma City homicide detectives would investigate this, we'd have this solved in 2 or 3 days. And
sir, we're out of time, but you've been gracious enough to be on the nightly news tonight. I want to start over where we left off here. Incredible.